So we have the privilege of hearing this morning from Rabbi David Fohrman on Sefer Yonah as we come into Yom Kippur. He is the principal educator at alephbeta.com. Really fantastic website. If some of you haven't seen it, I advise checking it out. He was a lead writer and editor for Art Scrolls Talmud Translation Project. He has two publications that he put out. One of the Beast That Crouches at the Door, and the second one, The Queen You Thought You Knew. And just before we start, I want to let you know that we do have also next month, Rabbi Dr. Joshua Berman will be coming in from Israel. He's a Tanakh professor at Bar Ilan University. He will be giving us a class on what is a berit, the marriage of God and Israel in Sefer Yechezkel as a prologue to Megillat Echa, which should be a very interesting topic. Keep in touch for dates and times. We really have a lot of the year planned out. Every month we will be having a scholar, a guest lecturer come educate us on our daily study. Whoever has not been keeping up, now is a great time to jump in. We are, you know, studying daily. We're up to Sefer Yechezkel now. Ovadia San, Perek Vav and Sefer Yechezkel. Ovadia San is teaching us as we are coming up on our culmination, our first year of studying. We started from Yehoshua, now we're already at Yechezkel. We started last Simchat Torah. So whoever hasn't joined or has fell out, now is a great time to just jump in again as we continue on finishing Nevi'im. We'll be starting Ketubim also as well this year. Before I introduce Rabbi David Fohrman, I just want to introduce Rabbi Sutton to say a couple of words.
I want to welcome everyone back and for our first lecture of the season. The series of lectures that have for this year has been sponsored and dedicated in memory of Rabbi Ezra Labaton. So, as fitting, I'll introduce with just a few words about Rabbi Labaton so that we can move forward. And I think it's very fitting that the Tanakh study, amongst the multiple possible talents and multiple pursuits of Rabbi Labaton, as we all know him in philosophy, was also an unending thirst for knowledge, especially in the area of Torah Shebichtav. And he used to complain all the time that Torah Shebichtav is not given its due study, and so many of his classes, unique to him, were focused on the understanding and the appropriate understanding and reading of Torah Shebichtav, of Tanakh study. So that, I think, is a very fitting tribute that to his memory, someone who dedicated himself to the whole understanding and knowledge of learning of the words of the Nevi'im, that all of these lectures are dedicated in his memory. Teshu Nishmatot Tzurah Chaim Amin. I will also add that the request also has been some of the Kal that we mentioned that the Limud should also be Lidui Nishmat Beracha Bat Rena. Okay. It's now my pleasure to introduce Rabbi Fohrman to talk about the topic of Yonah, which is an obvious reason we're headed into Yom Kippurim. The Navi Yonah is a key element of the Mincha Tefillah. So without further ado, be my honor call, Rabbi Fohrman.
Okay, nice to see you all. Pleasure to be here. It's my first time. And big yashar koach to Jesse Salem for putting together the Renaissance of Tanakh that I understand is kind of happening in this neighborhood, and for all of you for being a part of that. So congratulations on that. I'm happy to be a part of that today with a kind of presentation or discussion group, as it were, with you on Yonah. One word by way of introduction. We can try doing this in sort of discussion group style, which means that when I ask you a question, it's a genuine question and you can actually answer the question. It's not just rhetorical. So let me just jump in, I suppose, with a question that over the years had always bothered me about Sefer Yonah. By the way, just in case I forget to mention this at the end, if you want to review this talk, or you're not taking notes, or you want to get back to it, there's a version of this which you can get. I don't know how fast this will be out, but there's a version of it on our website, which you can see also in video form. I believe it goes by the same topic. I think it maybe it's Yonah, why did Yonah run? The website, again, is alephbeta.org, not actually alephbeta.com. It's a tricky name, one which maybe will change because nobody can pronounce it. It's not alpha beta, it's not aleph beta, it's aleph beta. So it's A-L-E-P-H, same word, B-E-T-A.org. But if you go there, there's a whole bunch of videos, 10-minute parsha videos, videos on holidays. One of them you'll see around this time of year is Yonah, so you can review this there or take a look at anything else we have. So the great question on Yonah this time of year is why exactly is it that we read this book on Yom Kippur? And the personal struggle that I remember always having with this as a kid is, you know, here it is, it's Yom Kippur. We could really pick anything to read as a Haftarah. There's plenty of inspiring Haftarahs in Sefer Yeshayahu. We could have picked anything. And yet, for some reason, we read Yonah. And it's not immediately clear why. The most obvious reason that I've heard about why we read Yonah is because Yom Kippur is a day of tshuva. And presumably, Sefer Yonah is a book about tshuva. So let me ask you this, does that work for you? In other words, could it be simply that Yom Kippur is a day of tshuva and Sefer Yonah is about tshuva? It could be the people of Nineveh do tshuva in the book, and it could be that the story is about them. The problem with that is that if you actually read the book, who do you say the story centers around? What is, right? Who's the main character in the story? See the problem here? It's not called Sefer Nineveh, right? It's called Sefer Yonah. The book is clearly about Yonah's journey. Sefer Nineveh is almost like a straw man. It's just part of it's not just part of the scenery. Obviously, they're people, and it's wonderful that they're saved. But it's just not the focus of the book. The book is not focused on their plight, right? If it were, you would imagine the book would be written from a whole different perspective. The first sentence of the book would be, once upon a time, there was a city called Nineveh, a very big city. Unfortunately, they were evil, right? And here is the story of what happens to them. And Yonah would just be a tangential thing. One day this guy, prophet, comes in, his name is Yonah. You wouldn't get the whole dramatic story of Yonah. The book is not told from the perspective of Nineveh, it's told from the perspective of Yonah, which makes things very difficult, because what if I asked you this question? Does Yonah ever do tshuva? Not really. And you would think that he has stuff to do tshuva on, right? I mean, like, he runs away from God. Does he ever apologize for that? Not so much, right? So then what if I made the argument, this is exactly the wrong book to be reading on Yom Kippur, you know? Teaches you what not to do, right? You run away from God, at least have the courtesy to say you're sorry, not like Yonah, right? Like, why is it that we're reading this book? The Sefer Yonah, about Yonah, what does Yonah's journey teach us on Yom Kippur? This question, I think, is intensified by the nature of the end of the book. I don't know if I'm the only guy in the room here who's bothered by this, but you ever, like, get to the end of the book and feel like asking, and then what? Do you know what I mean? Like, what happened next? Right? And there's, like, there's this great climactic story where Yonah's supposed to, like, learn his lesson, right? And he's taught this whole elaborate story with the gourd and the kikayon and stuff. And the problem is that the last person, the last one who speaks in that story is God. You know, he gives the lesson. And I always felt, I don't know about you, but I always felt like Yonah never gets to bat in the bottom of the ninth inning. You know what I mean? It's like you never get to hear Yonah's response. Like, if I was Yonah, I could have said something. I wouldn't necessarily be so impressed with that story, God. You know, what did Yonah actually say? It's interesting, by the way, if you look at some of the Midrashim on the story, the Midrashim will actually do this. They will construct a sort of hypothetical response on the part of Yonah, which you never actually get in the book. And it's very instructive, very interesting. For those of you who are interested, take a look at the last piece in Yalkut Shimoni on Yonah, which is it's a very elaborate medrash, but it's constructed out of trying to figure out what did Yonah respond. The end of the book is very difficult. What I want to focus with you on today really is the overarching question. It's like, what are you supposed to be thinking about? It must be that this book has something powerful to teach us about Yom Kippur. That must be why we read it. And yet, its message is oblique. It's not clear exactly what that powerful message is. Can we decipher what it is if we look at the text carefully, right? That's the basic theme that I want to do with you. And by the way, can I just ask a favor of someone? If there's a glass of water or something that you could grab for me, that would be wonderful. Thanks. Okay, so what I want to suggest is that there are probably two main questions and a bunch of smaller questions that we should be asking in the book. Right? Basically, our methodology is that we're going to just try to do the following. Erase in your head, this is a meditative exercise, everything you know about Sefer Yonah. Right? Imagine that you are a Baal Tshuva, a Baalat Tshuva, right? Or you're not even a Baalat Tshuva. Imagine you're Baruch Atah Adonai Melech Haolam Shehakol Midbaro. Imagine you are, completely outside of the orbit of Orthodox Judaism, and you just happen to come upon this book, and it's the first time you're reading it. And what are the questions that any intelligent person would ask just in reading the text? That's what we're going to try to do, right? Just forgetting everything you know about it, leaving all the preconceptions behind. You're looking at this book. What are the questions? This is a helpful exercise to do whenever you learn Tanakh, to try to clear your mind of everything you thought you knew. And once you do that, you'll find that there will be what I might call two kinds of questions that you could ask. Or let me talk to you about actually two distinctions you can make in the kind of questions you can ask. One distinction is big questions and little questions. It's a helpful distinction. Both big questions and little questions are important, but it's helpful to know the difference between them. A little question is a question, as I understand it, that doesn't destroy your understanding of the book. If you don't have the answer to this question, if you don't know why the verse has an extra word in it, right? So you don't know why the verse has an extra word in it, but that doesn't threaten your ability to understand the book. But there are some questions which, if you don't really have an answer to that question, you can't really look yourself in the mirror in the morning and say, I understand this book. If you're reading Migdal Bavel and you don't understand why it is that God doesn't like the tower, it's completely mysterious to you, like what does God have against this tower? That's a big question. It gets in the way of your entire understanding of the story. If you're reading the story of the Garden of Eden and you don't understand why God is, you don't understand, God's angry at them for eating the tree, but it's a tree of knowledge, good and evil, and that seems to mean that you understand moral distinctions when you eat from the tree, but before you ate from the tree, you don't understand moral distinctions. So if I don't understand moral distinctions, how come you're angry at me? What is this tree all about? That's like a very serious question. If you don't have an answer to that question, you don't understand the story. These are big questions. So there are big questions and there are small questions in Sefer Yonah. Let's begin by identifying the big questions and then go to the small ones. The small ones can be helpful when you put all of them together in helping you answer the big questions. Kind of look at questions as a sort of window. If you assemble enough of them, there are enough windows into the meaning that the big questions begin to resolve themselves. So one distinction I want to raise to you is the big question, little question distinction, and two kinds of questions you can ask. And the second distinction I want to raise to you is something I call the difference between external questions and internal questions. What I mean by an external question is an external question is a question that doesn't really come from the book. It comes from you. It's external to the book. You have certain baggage that you bring to the story, and you ask this question. And while it's very interesting, that kind of question, the question actually says more about you than it says about the book. So we're less interested in those questions because they're not going to help us that much understand the book. So for example, if someone would say, you know what my big question, say, for Yonah is? Like, Yonah spends 3 days in a fish. Like, how could he survive for 3 days in a fish? Like, I don't get that. No one survives 3 days in a fish, right? Can you please explain that to me? That's a very interesting question, but that's an external question that has nothing to do with the book. The answer to that question is it was a miracle, okay? The book believes in miracles. There's lots of miracles in the Torah, and the book believes in miracles. You don't believe in miracles? You have a problem with miracles? Okay, you have a problem with miracles. So we can address the issue of, you know, do miracles happen or don't miracles happen? But that's not a question in Sefer Yonah. That's a question about your relationship to miracles. Do you understand? It's an external question to the book. There are internal questions that you need to ask. And the internal questions are basically saying, look, I'll leave behind all of my preconceptions. I'll accept the book on its own terms. But when I'm reading the book, internally, the book doesn't seem to make sense to me because here it says this and here it says this, and these things don't go together and it just doesn't make sense. I don't get the book on its own terms. That's a much more interesting question because the answer to that question is going, right? If the question comes from the book itself, the answer is going to come from the book itself. It's going to enhance your understanding of the book. Okay, so what we really want to do is we want to be looking for internal questions in the book, and let's start with big questions, and then we'll go to little questions. What would you say the top two big questions in Sefer Yonah would be? Yeah?
Why is Yonah running?
Big question number one is certainly, why is Yonah running, right? I mean, how do you start a book? Look how Sefer Yonah starts. Vayhi Dvar Hashem al Yonah ben Amitai Lemor. By the way, if you have a Tanakh, helpful to have a Tanakh. If you don't have a Tanakh, there are Tanakhim over here, but it would be good to grab some or look on with somebody next to you. Okay. So big question number one has got to be, why did Yonah run? And you see it just from the beginning of the book. Vayhi Dvar Hashem al Yonah ben Amitai Lemor. The word of God came to Yonah the son of Amittai, saying, Kum leichal Ninveh ha'ir agdala kra alea ki ata ra'atam lefanai. Go call up against Ninveh. Their evil has come up before me, has come up to me. Go to Ninveh. Vayakam Yonah livroch Tarshisham livnei Hashem, vayered Yafo vayimtza niyabah Tarshish. Then Yonah got up and ran away from before God and went to Tarshish. And the question you're left asking is, okay, so like why is he running? Like why couldn't he just do what God said? Now, especially because Yonah is a prophet, right? He's an established prophet. He's referred to in Sefer Melachim as a prophet also. So if Yonah's a prophet, like why would you go into the prophecy business, choose that profession? You know, if you're not going to, God finally calls out to you, you know, it's like this is your call, so you're going to do what God wants. It's very strange to have a prophet who immediately, without any explanation, just simply disobeys what God wants, flat out, without the prophet or the text explaining at all the reason why. So it's like the book has to assume that you're going to be bothered by that question, right? So that is question number one. That is big question number one that the book is just begging you to grapple with. It's saying, like, if you're an intelligent reader, the first thing you have to do is you have to read this book carefully with an eye towards figuring out why did Yonah run, right? And it's almost like the book is putting that question in your court and saying you have to be an active reader. It's up to you to figure this out. I'm not telling you. Look carefully and you'll see, right? So that is question number one. What do you say question number two is? If you'd have to say there's only two big questions in Sefer Yonah, the second other big question in the book. Right, so I'm going to call that a subcategory of question one, right? The subcategory of question one is like, and even if we can understand your motivation from running away, how can we understand why you think you would be successful in running away? If you're a prophet, don't you know that that God is everywhere, that God's going to catch up to you? You can't really think that this is going to work, do you, right? And in fact, it doesn't work, right? Yonah does not successfully run away from God. So you have to ask yourself, like, if Yonah does not have a childish conception of God, if he realizes that God is the master of the universe and can catch up with him wherever he runs, why is he running? Even if you could figure out a motivation for him to run, how do you understand how Yonah doesn't think this is just futile and it's ridiculous? So, right, if this adds to the question of why does Yonah run? Okay, good. Anything else? Any other questions? Anything else that ever bothered you about the book? I'm sorry? I'm sorry. I didn't realize there's people over here, too. Go ahead. Give me your name again. You are? Michael. Go ahead.
So what's the lesson that you're not learning at the end of the story?
So that has to be question number two, big question number two. There's a big question at the beginning of the book, why does Yonah run? And there's a big question at the end of the book, why, what does he learn from the end of the book? And to see that, right, there's this elaborate story with the gourd and the worm and stuff like that. So let's just go to that story and kind of role play it a little bit. And you'll see, you know, I'll play God, and Michael, you'll play Yonah, right? And we'll see, like, you know, at every stage you can, you know, so let's see. All right, so here it is. Nineveh has repented, right? For some reason you're not into that, okay? You're very upset. You made yourself this little sukkah, you know, you see? And so all of a sudden, I, God, decide I've got like the perfect thing over here, right? So I start with making this big plant, this gourd, right? It comes up and provides shade for you. Michael, how are you feeling about this plant?
Ecstatic.
He's so happy. Vayismach Yonah simcha gdola, right? He has a simcha gdola, right? Because of this plant. Simcha gdola, by the way, is a rare term in Tanakh. Aside from Yonah, the other places it appears is Shlomo's coronation, right? Is a simcha gdola, right? So we're talking about really, really happy thing. So as Michael said, he's ecstatic about this plant. So Yonah definitely is a fellow given to, you know, great displays of emotion over here. Anyway, so now along comes, it's very hot outside, you're happy, right? So can you explain to me, why are you happy, right? I mean,
I finally got some shade,
right? It's wonderful, okay. Along comes this worm, right? Worm overnight destroys the plants. Withered plant. How are you feeling, Yonah?
Depressed, and I want to die.
Depressed, you want to die, right? Boy, that's pretty heavy. Really wants to die. So I say, aha, I've got it. Okay, you know your problem, Michael? Let me explain to you, Michael. Ata chasta la kikayon, right? You had mercy on that plant, right? You know the trouble with you, Michael, is you don't have enough mercy. You had mercy on the plant. You're willing to have mercy on the plant. Vani lo achusal ninveh. You know, you didn't even put anything into that plant. I put all this stuff into the plant. I shouldn't have compassion on Ninveh, this big city. Huh? Huh? What do you think? Right? Now imagine you get to bat in the bottom of the ninth inning. What would you say? Are you convinced?
No.
You're not convinced? Why not?
Why? It doesn't seem so emet of you to have the hamim on a people that was so terrible for so many years and all of a sudden be niham al hara.
Okay, yeah, but the plant? What about the plant? I mean, you were so happy about the plant, right? So what would you say? Like, would you say, like I say, ata chasti l'kikayon, you had compassion on that plant. You could really take issue with me right there.
Because it has direct benefit.
Yeah, you could just say, I didn't have compassion on the plant. It was air conditioning. You know what I mean? It was hot. Sue me. I was happy about the plant. You know what I mean? Like, what does that have to do with Ninveh? I just do not get it. Do you know what I mean? So it's like, what is happening in the end of the book? How is that supposed to be a really exciting solution for the end of the book? Now, the truth is that as difficult, we've identified two main questions in the book. Question at the beginning of the book, why do you want to run? Question at the end of the book, what does he learn from the story of the plant? As difficult as each of these questions are to answer, they become more difficult when you put them together. Because you have to realize that the questions are actually linked to each other. In other words, however it is that you understand the answer to the first question, that Yonah ran away, why Yonah ran away, that's going to influence how you understand the answer to the second question, which is, what does the plant teach him? The plant has to teach him why he shouldn't have run away or something, right? They're linked to each other. So you have to be able to kind of make that fit. And that's not really so easy. To show you that, I just want to entertain a couple possible theories, almost like straw man theories, as to why it might be that Yonah ran away. And these are theories which various folks, different folks suggest. And I want to show you that, you know, you might posit that this is why Yonah ran away, but it's very difficult to work the theory through the whole book, right? And what we really want is a theory that's actually going to make it through the whole book. So let me give you a couple possibilities. Possibility number one, Yonah ran away because, and there are some who suggest this, he did not want to be known as a false prophet, right? In other words, what's happening? God says, go to Nineveh and tell them they're going to be destroyed, as he in fact does, right? He says, tell them they're going to be destroyed after 40 days. More 40 more days, Nineveh will be destroyed. Now, let's say you're Yonah, and you say to yourself, well, I know this isn't actually going to happen. People are probably going to do tshuva. God's probably a nice guy, right? He's probably going to forgive them. And look who's going to be holding the bag over here. Me. I'm going to look like the idiot. Here I go. I tell them that they're all going to be destroyed. They're not. And I end up looking like a laughing stock. I'm not interested. Right? Some argue that Yonah did not want to be perceived as a false prophet or as a liar in case things didn't work out that way. Does that satisfy you? And if it doesn't satisfy you, why not? Okay, so you know that because the Rambam says it, right? But the people of Nineveh might not be such Rambam scholars, right? So maybe the people of Nineveh are going to be laughing and jeering, right? So you're right, actually. That's true. But maybe Yonah feels like, you know, I don't know, I look like a fool. Not everybody knows that. I know that, and that's why I think God's probably not going to follow through. But the average person, I'm going to look silly. So even so, does this make sense to you? Yeah. Okay, so let me take your answer and sort of tweak it just a little bit. I think that's an effective answer. Here's what you could say. If that's the moral of this book, that was really what was on Yonah's mind, that Yonah didn't want to go to the people and say, Od arba'im yom v'nimve ne'apachet, 40 more days Nineveh will be destroyed if it wasn't going to really happen. There's an easy solution to that problem that would not have required four chapters of Sefer Yonah. Here's how the book should have gone, right? The book should have gone that sentence number one, God calls out to Yonah and says, I want you to go to Nineveh, and then maybe we should actually get what he's supposed to say. Say, 40 more days and Nineveh will be destroyed. Now, Yonah doesn't want to do that. We know Yonah doesn't want to do that because he's afraid that he'll look like a fool. So at that point, if you're Yonah, what should you do instead of running away? He's a very simple solution. You say, God, great idea, love the plan. It's just, I have a little problem. You see, I don't want to look like a false prophet over here, but I think you're going to forgive them. If they forgive them, I know you're going to forgive them. It's a bad prophecy. Bad prophecies don't actually happen if people do tshuva. How about if we amend the speech that I'm supposed to give to Nineveh slightly? Instead of saying 40 more days and Nineveh will be destroyed, how about if you say, have me say 40 more days and Nineveh will be destroyed unless you guys do tshuva. Perfect. I'm happy. You're happy. They get the message. Everybody wins. It's a win-win scenario. And the book could be over right then. Sefer Yonah is two sentences long, right? And then the moral of the story, that we have such a long Sefer Yonah, we don't need the fish. We don't need them swallowed. We don't need anything. And the moral of the story would then be that, look, the Sefer Yonah is a testament to what happens when there's ineffective communication between people. Do you know what I mean? If only Yonah would have just said this, we could have had a two-sentence book, but he didn't, so he had to go through all of this. Right? That's ridiculous. That is not the message of Sefer Yonah. We don't have four chapters because Yonah couldn't get that to say it the right way. So the theory that Yonah didn't want to be called a liar seems like it's just not going to work. It's not going to make its way through the book. Let's take a second possibility. Second possibility might be, and I've heard students who've suggested this over the years, perhaps Yonah's just not such a nice guy. You know, maybe he's a curmudgeon. Maybe he's just, you know, he's very happy to have gourds and things, you know, for himself because it benefits him. But he doesn't like it when things happen that don't really benefit him. So if God's going to be nice to these people of Nineveh, it's just he's a selfish guy. He's very happy for God to be nice to him. He doesn't want God to be nice to anybody else. Does that work? in this book. If you had to disprove that from the book itself, how could you disprove that?
He's very kind to the sailors.
Think about it. If you were Yonah and you were a selfish guy, then think what happens. There's a storm. And you know the storm is kind of because of you, right? Because you were running away from God. There's a storm. And the sailors, who are kind of naive, they come to him and they say, what should we do to make the storm stop storming? You know? And he says it's because, you know? So at that point, would you say, throw me overboard? Or would you say, why don't you try rowing harder back to shore, guys? I mean, you'd say, let's row harder back to shore, right? I mean, like, throw me overboard is a pretty impressive display of self-sacrifice for somebody who's not into self-sacrifice. And by the way, think about also his reaction when God actually does the thing he doesn't want him to do, which is forgive Nineveh. If it's coming from a place of selfishness, right, and he lost the battle because God was nice to someone who wasn't him, right? Look at Yonah's response. What does Yonah want to do once he finds out that Nineveh is going to be forgiven? What does he say? Vatashem, kach na nafshi mimeni, ki tov moti mechayai. He says, I want you to kill me now because it's better for me to be dead than alive. That's pretty heavy. And it doesn't exactly sound like the kind of thing that a selfish person would do after he's lost his sort of selfish battle. To give you an example, right? Imagine you're a parent and you have two kids, Bobby and Debbie. And one day you decide to take them to ice cream. So you take them to your local Baskin-Robbins and you're going to buy them. You give them a chance to buy any flavor they want. So Debbie, you know, takes her mint chocolate chip. And Bobby says, I want a double scoop, right? Now, Debbie didn't have a double scoop. I want a double scoop, but Debbie had a single scoop. We're having single scoops today. Now, Debbie can have a single scoop. I want a double scoop, right? So okay, you're the parent. What do you do? Single scoop or nothing. So you put your foot down. Bobby, at this point, presses the nuclear button, okay? Bobby starts having a tantrum in the middle of Baskin-Robbins. No, I am having my double scoop. I'm having it, I'm having it, I'm having it, right? And he starts kicking with his feet on the floor. What do you do now? So if you're a good parent, you know, you have your steely resolve. You ignore Bobby's tantrum, right? You go to the, as if nothing is happening, you pay for the single scoop. Either he takes it or he doesn't, and that's it. So imagine you're walking now out of Baskin-Robbins after this little episode. Bobby has his pralines and cream, one scoop, you know, and Debbie has her mint chocolate chip. Now, what's going to happen next with Bobby, right? Is Bobby A, going to gird himself for his next battle with Debbie? You know, that's what he's going to do. Or is Bobby going to get this sort of glassy-eyed stare in the parking lot, look up to heaven and say, there's no option but suicide now. You know, now that I have lost my battle with Debbie, life is no longer worth living. You don't do that, you know what I mean? It's like there's always another day. You know, if I'm a selfish person, it doesn't affect me that deeply. For Yonah, it really affects him. Do you know what I mean? This guy wants to die. It's like life is no longer worth living in this world anymore. Very strange. Something is happening with him, which is deeper than I'm a selfish guy, right? So here are two theories that don't seem to work. Yonah doesn't want to be perceived as a liar. Yonah doesn't want to be selfish. Yonah may be selfish. What about theory number three? Theory number three, let's call it Yonah as a Jewish patriot theory. And this theory goes something like this. Who exactly were the Ninevites? Nineveh, historically, was the capital city of Ashur, of Assyria. These were not the good guys, right? So, in other words, a generation from now, Sennacherib is going to swoop down from Ashur, is going to wage war against everything. The 10 tribes are going to get exiled. He's going to swoop down, going to invade further into Yehuda, destroys the second largest city of Judah, gets turned back to the gates of Yerushalayim. It's like a real crisis, right? So Nineveh not good guys, and especially from the perspective, right, it's the Iran of the time. Do you know what I mean? It's like, so imagine everything you put into, like, no Iran deal. So imagine, you know, you can imagine Yonah as, like, Netanyahu. Do you know what I mean? It's like, no, just say no. Do you know what I mean? So this is him. It's like, hello, you're asking me to go to these guys and get them to do what? So that they can do tshuva, so that they can be saved for another day, so that they can come in another generation, another 15 years, and make war against us and destroy everything? No, I'm not doing that, right? You're going to have somebody else. Maybe that's Yonah, in which case, you know, Yonah's quite a hero. He's willing to actually go up toe-to-toe against the master of the universe himself, because he is a Jewish patriot, and he's not going to do something that gets his people into trouble. A very attractive theory, possibly, right? Much more attractive than the previous two theories that I suggested. Can anyone suggest a problem with this theory? Why this theory might not make it all the way through the book? What would the problem be here? Okay, true. So first of all, Yonah doesn't look like he wins at the end, and he doesn't even seem to get praised for this position. This seems to be a pretty praiseworthy position. If you think, by the way, about going through Jewish history, who could you imagine who sort of kind of sounds like this, by the way? A Jewish patriot who's willing to actually oppose God to try to save the people when the people are, when the people themselves, God would just get rid of them, were it not for this person who's willing to stand between God and the people. This is Moshe. This is Moshe at the golden calf. And Moshe at the golden calf totally comes out the winner, right? Now, Moshe is a great hero in that situation. So if Yonah's in that situation, you would expect Yonah to be treated in the same way. Yonah doesn't seem to emerge as the great hero. So that's one problem. Any other problem with working this theory through the rest of the book? Yeah, you would think like Yonah, you would think Yonah should say it at some point, right? Like, God, and by the way, what better time to say it than in the story of the plant? Let's go back to my discussion with Michael. Michael, get into character here. You are a Jewish patriot, right? So imagine this is why Michael is just not going to do this. He is not going to cross. He's willing to even oppose God, right? If it if it comes to it. So here I am, God, and I'm going to teach Michael a lesson, right? So now, and you guys can like advise Michael on what to say. What would you tell Michael to say to God? So here I am, God. So I got this great plant, good air conditioning, right? You're sitting underneath your air conditioner, you're really happy. Along comes the worm, takes away the air conditioning, you're very upset. Say, aha, Michael, you know the problem with you? Not enough compassion, right? You have compassion on the wrong things. You had compassion on that gourd, that plant, right? So why can't you muster up a little compassion for the folks in Nineveh, huh? I mean, like, what's wrong with you? You had compassion on the plant. What would you say? You're just, you know, problem with you, Michael, you're just not a compassionate enough guy.
Well, God, they're
terrorists. Right? Compassionate terrorists. That's right. So you'd say, and you'd say, and what would you say to me when I say you're not enough, you're not a compassionate guy? Do you think you're not enough compassionate guy? That's right. You say, God, I'm a very compassionate guy, but let's ask who I have compassion on. I'm going to have compassion on the Jews, right? I'm not going to have compassion on the terrorists, right? That's a perfectly fine argument. And why would the book end without giving Yonah a chance to make that perfectly fine argument? That's such a good argument. So it doesn't sound like that can have been Yonah's motivation, because the whole end of the book just doesn't work, right? It just doesn't work. One other final theory, this theory is actually suggested by Rashi, which also at some level seems to run into some problems, at least if you think that Rashi is giving you pshat in the book. My own feeling is that Rashi's quoting a medrash here, and the medrash is not intending to explain the pshat of the story. It's intending to give you a midrashic explanation that rides on top of pshat. I don't want to get too much into the difference between pshat and drash, but let me just say one thing, that one of the tricky things with interpreting midrash is that midrash is not always there to tell you what the simple meaning of the text is. More often than not, it relies upon you to understand the simple meaning of the text, and once you understand it, it will tell you something more subtle that rides on top of that in the form of drash. So this is a good example of this, because if you believe that this Midrash is explaining the pshat of the story, it's going to run into problems. It seems to be, my theory is that Rashi thinks that it's up to you to figure out pshat, and this is going to give you another layer on top of that. Here's what the Midrash says. The Midrash that Rashi quotes, that you may have learned in school about Yonah, goes something like this. It's Yonah as a patriot, but as a Jewish patriot, but Yonah as a spiritual Jewish patriot. And it goes something like this. Yonah is worried about creating an unfavorable contrast in the mind of God, as it were. Yonah knows that over time, prophet after prophet has come to the Jewish people and told them to repent. And typically, those prophets get ignored. And that must be very frustrating to God. All of a sudden, here he comes, and he receives this prophecy that a Gentile nation should repent. And Yonah has this sneaking suspicion that they're going to do it. And he's afraid of what happens if he's successful. If he's successful, if he gets these people to repent, and they repent just like that, which in fact happens, that is going to create an unfavorable contrast in the mind of God between the Gentile nations and between the Jews. Yonah's worried, according to the Midrash, that God's going to come after this and say, hey, I send prophet after prophet to the Jewish people. They ignore them, right? Now, okay, maybe that's life. Maybe that's humanity. And maybe I'd be willing to live with that in a vacuum, except all of a sudden, here I come, and I send one lousy prophet to this Gentile nation, and all of a sudden, there's 110,000 people all doing tshuva just like this. And I don't even have any special relationship with them. They're not my chosen people. So if that's what human beings are capable of, if that's how people should respond to prophets, and look, they did it, so what do I need the Jews for, right? I have this special relationship with them, and they're ignoring me. That's not good, and that would cause an unfavorable contrast in the mind of God, leading perhaps to Israel's destruction, right? That is seemingly a very attractive theory, very nice theory. What's wrong with this theory? Yeah. Okay, but evidently it lasts long enough that they're going to be surviving. My question is, why could this? Could this work as pshat through the book, or is there a problem with making this work as your theory of why Yonah ran away? What's the problem with this theory? Is there any problem with it? Yeah. Okay, again, Yonah never really mentions it. And also, if you look carefully, there's a particular point in the text where this doesn't seem to work. Because the truth is, there is a moment where Yonah actually, towards the end of the book, sort of kind of tries to explain why he ran away. He actually does. Let's take a look at the text and see what he says. You'll find it at the end of Perek Gimel. No, maybe not there. Sorry, you'll find the beginning of Perek Dalet. Yep. Look at Dalet Bet. Vayitpalel al Hashem vayomer. Ana Hashem, I'm reading now from Perek Dalet Pasuk Bet. Halozet vari al heyotzat mati. God, why do you think I ran away? This is what I was thinking when I was back in my own land. Al kein kidamti livroch Tarshisha. Here's why I ran away to Tarshish in the first place. Now we're going to get it. We're going to get Yonah's own explanation of why he ran away. So let's listen carefully to why he ran away. Now before we do, let's play fill in the blanks. If this theory that I've just suggested to you is right, what should Yonah actually say now? Imagine, right, Michael, you're, right? Get into character. You're the spiritual savior of the Jewish people, spiritual patriot. What should Michael say? God, I knew this would happen. This is why I ran away to Tarshish, because I knew
that you're a compassionate God.
No. You're telling me what the text says. Forget what the text says. I want to know what you should say. Get into character, right? The reason why you don't want to do this is because what are you afraid of?
I'm afraid that this is going to look terrible.
What's going to look terrible?
If these terrorists do the Teshuvah immediately,
right,
this is going to look
It's going to look horrible. So that's what he's worried about. So now, finish the sentence. God, this is why I ran away, because I knew or all you even have to say is the first part of the sentence. I knew that they would do tshuva, and I wasn't interested. That's what he's upset about, right? I knew this would happen, that they would do tshuva. Look at what he actually says. Yonah does not say that. Al ken kidamti levro tashishtri. Here's what he actually says. Ki adati, because I knew. Kikel chanun v'rachum ata v'nicham alara. I knew that you're a gracious and merciful God, and that you would change your mind about destroying them. That was the wrong thing to say. Think carefully. What's bothering Michael is not really God's response of compassion to the people of Nineveh. He'd care less about that. What bothers him is that the second that the people do tshuva, regardless of how God responds, regardless of whether God accepts the tshuva or doesn't accept the tshuva, the mere fact that these people have responded when Bnei Yisrael hasn't, that's his problem. He should have said, ki adati, because I knew that they would respond that way, and I didn't want that response to happen. Why doesn't he say that? So again, it's a nice theory. It just somehow doesn't seem to really work with the words. So what could actually work here? How are we going to understand this book? And why, again, is it so meaningful in Yom Kippur? If we could understand the answer to question A and how question A works its way to question B, right? Why Yonah ran away and why the story of the gourd is actually meaningful, then we'd be able to maybe figure out what this book is about. Okay, so we have four theories that don't work right now. Let me begin to sketch out a theory that might work. But in order to do that, I want to take account of some of the smaller questions. We've talked about the big questions, big question number one, big question number two, beginning of the book, end of the book. What are some of the smaller questions on the book? Let me raise a couple with you. In no particular order, let me just throw out a bunch of them. Let's read the end of the story, Perek Dalet, parts of Perek Dalet. Here's the scene. The end of Perek Gimel tells us God changes mind and is not going to destroy Nineveh, right? Now, Perek Dalet then continues. God has decided not to destroy Nineveh. What does Yonah do? Yonah's very upset. He wants to die. Pasuk Hey, Vayetze Yonah min ha'ir, Vayeshev mikedem le'ir, Vayas lo sham sukkah, Vayeshev tachtei abatzel. He makes himself a little sukkah to sit in its shade. Ad asher yireh ma'ayyeh ba'ir. Until he sees what's going to happen with the city. Now, what's strange about that until he sees what's going to happen with the city? If you've been reading Perek Gimel, what do you already know? You know that God forgave them. God already said, I forgive them. I'm changing my mind. I'm not going to do the bad thing. And he told Yonah that. And Yonah already expressed how disappointed he was that God did that. So Yonah knows good as well that God has changed his mind. Isn't it strange then that he would then decide to stick around specifically in this very hot place, make himself a sukkah right outside the city, specifically ad asher yira ma'ya ba'ir, to see what's going to happen with the city? Like, what's the suspense? The game is over. You know what I mean? It reminds me, I remember when I was a kid, strange little story, but I remember I was a baseball fan when I was a kid. I'm like 12 years old. I'm in San Francisco, and I remember there was a World Series between the Oakland A's and the Kansas City Royals. So Oakland is in the Bay Area. I was a fan of the Oakland A's. And the Oakland A's, I believe they won the World Series, or at least they won the game. I think they won the World Series. There was a picture on the front page of the sports section after the A's won the World Series, a picture of, I forget what the guy, what his name was, but one of the star players for Kansas City in the dugout after the loss, with his head in his hands, and he's just crying into his hands about 10 minutes after the game, and there's no one in the dugout, and there's no one in the stands, and it's just him in the dugout with his head in his hands, just crying. And it's like, you feel so bad for this guy, but the other thing is like, it's over. Do you know what I mean? It's like, and he, what? Why is he still in the dugout? Do you know what I mean? It's almost like the pathos of the situation is, it's like, he just can't believe it. Do you know what I mean? I can't go down and let go. It's like, how could this have happened? And it's like, and you almost feel like that's Yonah. Do you know what I mean? How he's gonna stick around to see if maybe this will change, even though God says it's over, game over, right? I'm not gonna do it. Yonah is so bothered by that. He so wants to die. He just can't believe it's over. He's gonna make a sukkah. He's just shell shocked. I can't believe this is happening. Let me see what actually happens to the city. So here is Yonah. He's got his sukkah. He has a shade, and he's there. What happens next? Vayimana Hashem Elokim Kikayon. God then makes the plant rise up. Now, if you would question God, you say, God, why are you making this plant? For what purpose? What's it there for? What would God answer? To provide shade for Yonah. Okay, but if you've been reading the text carefully, what's wrong with that explanation? He already has shade. He made himself a sukkah specifically for shade. It says that. He made a sukkah for shade. Immediately after it says he made a sukkah for shade, we have this plant, and if it's there for shade, it's superfluous. So what's the plant there for? And in fact, it says, liot tzel al rosho, that the plant is there for shade. So why would God create a superfluous plant to provide shade? And now the question is, back to Michael, why then is Michael so upset about the loss of the plant? He already had air conditioning. He already had a hut that was providing him shade. So it matters that it was the plant that was providing the shade, it was the hut that, he had shade. So it's like this whole story is starting to fall apart. It's like it was a duplicate plant. Like, what is it there for? Yes?
It just seems like he's very upset with God's compassionate nature. Like, that's bothering him, the fact that he is constantly forgiving people who, in Yonah's eyes, don't seem to deserve forgiveness.
Okay.
So it looks like God is sticking it to him here, being like, okay, you want to be mad anyway? Watch, I'm going to make you shade anyway, even though you made for yourself.
Ah, okay, very interesting. So we'll get back to that. I think you might be onto something there. But the point for the meantime is that the shade is duplicate shade, right? Now, if you look very carefully at the text, you will see there's actually a second reason for why God makes the plant, not just for shade. According to the text, what's the second reason that God made the plant? That's right. The first reason is liot tzel al rosho, but the second is lahatzilo mira'ato. Now the question is, what does that mean? Now you can translate the words, because the words aren't so difficult to translate, but what the words mean is hard to understand. Lahatzilo means to save him. Here's the hard word, meraato, from his evil. Now the question is, what the heck does that mean? To save him from his ra'a, from his evil? Like, what's the evil here? So, so you will have some translations. By the way, I believe maybe even Art School translates this way. You can tell me over there. Some translations, how do they translate it? Anyone have the English translation?
To relieve him from his discomfort.
To relieve him from his discomfort, Art School says. Now that's convenient, right? That's a very convenient translation. But it ain't what it says. Do you know what I mean? It does not say to relieve him from his discomfort. We could have found a way to say that, right? It says to relieve him or to save him from his evil. That's a much weirder, harsher thing to say than to relieve him from his discomfort. And again, he didn't really have much discomfort because it's a duplicate plant. He already had the shade. So the text seems to realize that you know that it's a duplicate plant and says, no, there was another reason. It was to save him from his evil. Now the question is, what's the evil? Yes. So maybe, right? Maybe it's some kind of depression. Does the text tell us what the evil is?
Also, isn't it true that God cannot communicate with
another? Interesting. So he has to save that disposition in order to be able to. Right? Yes. Interesting possibility that he needs to get rid of his depression in order to be happy so that he can be in a place that he can understand. Right? Interesting possibility. So we'll come back to this. What was his evil? But let me just point out one or two other questions, and then we'll kind of put this all together. Let's say I give you a pop quiz on the end of Nineveh right now, and I asked you a few questions. And the main question I had to you was, please explain to me why the people of Yonah were, why the people of Nineveh were saved in one sentence or less. The people of Nineveh were saved because they did tshuva, okay? Let's now read the end of the book and see if the end of the book supports our thesis. Here is God explaining to Yonah why he saved the people of Nineveh. Vani lo achus al Nineveh, ha'ir hagdola, last sentence of the book. And I shouldn't have compassion and save Nineveh. Why? Because asher, it's an ir hagdola, it's a big city. Asher yesh ba harbe mishtei mesre rivo adam, it's got more than 120,000 people. Asher lo yada ben yimino l'smolo, they don't know the difference between their right hand and their left hand. Ubeima rabba, plus they've got lots of cattle. Did you hear anything about tshuva? Did I miss something here? It's like, this is the moment. If this story is about the power of tshuva, if this is the great Yom Kippur story about the efficacy of tshuva, isn't this the moment to plug that? You know, the power of tshuva. So here comes God with the knockout punch. Michael, you know, you don't understand the power of tshuva. Look, they did tshuva, right? And so that's why I saved them. No, not a word. Very big city, 120,000 people. Lots of cattle, don't know the difference between the right hand and left hand, that's why I saved them. Hello, did you miss something? Like, what about the tshuva part, right? Like, no, it was lots of cattle, right? What was that about? Like, you know, so what is happening at the, why did tshuva get ignored at the end of the book if tshuva is really so great? Very strange. By the way, some weird things that Chazal do in this, with this book that are strange too. For example, the fish. How many fish in Yonah? One fish, right? Nope, not according to Chazal. See, the first time that the fish shows up, swallows Yonah, it's known as a dag. But the second time the fish shows up, it's called a dagah, feminine. Chazal then interpret that and say, well, actually there were two fish. You see, the first fish swallowed Yonah, but Yonah wasn't actually praying in that fish, so God had to have him spat out of that fish, mouth-to-mouth resuscitation, into a female fish. Female fish was actually pregnant, not a lot of room, so he was very uncomfortable. That's when he prayed. It's like, oh, come on. Like, you really, why are you telling me this ridiculous story about two fish just because there's an extra hay? Okay, so live with it. You know what I mean? Like, why are you telling me about two fish in this story? Like, how am I supposed to explain that to my, you know, to Joe on the plane who's sitting next to me? It's like, no, there were actually two fish. There was a female fish. It's like, leave a good enough story alone. It's a strange enough story as it is. Why are you telling me about the second fish? So how do we understand Chazal over here? Okay. Let's try to begin to put this together. Take all of these big questions and little questions. What do they add up to? I asked you the question about the ra'ah. The purpose of the gourd, according to the text, was not just to provide shade for him, but lahatzil lo mira'ato, to save him from his ra'ah. It turns out that ra'ah is a word which, if you want to understand what it means here, you have to realize that the word appears consistently throughout the story. You have to actually pay attention to the train, what I'm going to call the train of ra'ah throughout the story. Let's take a look at the train of ra'ah. Where's the first ra'ah in the story? Very first ra'ah in the story. Very beginning. First ra'ah is the ra'ah of Nineveh. Alta ra'atam lefanai. Their evil has come up before me. What's the second ra'ah in the story? Few sentences later. Yep, and what is that? The second ra'ah is when Yonah's on the boat. The euphemism for the storm is ra'ah. B'shelmi ha-ra'ah zot. Why is this ra'ah happening to us? Why is this bad thing happening to us? This is a terrible storm. Yonah's running away. The next time you have ra'ah is in the end of the third parak. What is ra'ah over here? Look at the end of the third parak. The people of Nineveh, they all do tshuva. They, why? Vayeshvu ish midarko hara'ah. There again, their repenting from their evil, the evil of Nineveh. When's the next ra'ah after that? Next pasuk. God sees that they've done tshuva from their evil ways. What's the next ra'ah after that? Nope. Same pasuk. Take a look at the last pasuk in Perek Gimel, Yud. Vayar lakim ma'asem ki shavu midarkam ra'ah. God saw that they returned from their evil ways, and then what did God do? Vayinachem Elokim al hara'ah asher diber la'asot lahem. Then God changed his mind about the ra'ah that he was going to do to them. Right? First, it's their ra'ah, right? But now it's the ra'ah that God was going to impose upon them. What's the next ra'ah? Look at the beginning of the next pasuk in Parashat Daled. Vayera el Yonah ra'ah gadola. Oh, that was Yonah's ra'ah. You want to know what Yonah's ra'ah with the plant was? Here it is. Vayera el Yonah ra'ah gadola. That's his ra'ah. Do you see the train of ra'ah now? Then the next ra'ah is going to be it's going to be Rav Chesed v'nicham al ra'ah, which we'll get to in a moment. And then finally, there's the gourd, l'hatzil lo mera'ato, which ra'ah? The ra'ah that we've been talking about before. Vayera el ra'ah Yonah ra'ah gadola. The train of ra'ah, you just have to go backwards. You say, okay, so what was the ra'ah of the plant? When the plant was there to save Yonah from the ra'ah of Vayera el Yonah ra'ah gadola. Where was Vayera el Yonah ra'ah gadola coming from? From the fact that God had changed his mind about doing the ra'ah to the people, right? For their ra'ah, because the people had undone their ra'ah, and therefore they weren't ra'ah anymore, and that's why Yonah was ra'ah. That's l'hatzil lo mera'ato. Okay? It's this sort of domino thing, right? It's like dominoes. Keep that image in your mind, dominoes. What do dominoes suggest? Dominoes are all about cause and effect. It's addition and subtraction. Right? A plus B plus C, and it's for every cause there is an effect, for every effect there is a cause, right? That's how dominoes work. If a domino falls, it's because another domino hit it, right? For every effect there is a cause, for every cause there is an effect. If a domino falls, what's going to happen? It's going to hit another domino, and it's going to fall. That seems to be the system in which Yonah is working, in which the book is working. It's Yonah's, in a way, his whole world, that system. We'll give a name for that system in a moment. The text, in a way, gives a name for it. There's one more ra'ah, which I sort of slipped over. It's a ra'ah right before the ra'ah of the plant. It's, in a way, the most important ra'ah of all, because it's the ra'ah involved in Yonah's own explanation of why he ran away. When Yonah explains to God why he ran away, the word ra'ah appears. Look carefully. That's right. You know why I ran away? Al ken kidabti livroach tarshish. I'm reading now from Perek Dalet Pasuk Beit. Ki adati, because I knew ki ata kel chanun v'rachum. I knew you were a gracious and compassionate God. Erach apayim, slow to anger, rav chesed, full of kindness, v'nicham al ra'ah, and someone who changes your mind about doing evil. That's why I was so upset. My ra'ah was because you changed your mind about the ra'ah that you were going to inflict. Your nicham al ra'ah. That's why I'm so upset. Now, if you listen to that whole sentence, and you play one of our favorite games, Where Have We Heard This Before? You've heard this before. These are the Yud Gimel Midot HaRachamim, right? We say the minus one. That's right. If you think of the Yud Gimel Midot HaRachamim, the Yud Gimel Midot HaRachamim, the 13 attributes of compassion, are 13 attributes of compassion that God revealed to Moshe in the story after the golden calf. We were talking about the golden calf before, the moment that Moshe is the hero that saves the people. Well, in that story, Hashem reveals himself as a compassionate God to Moshe. Speaking of Moshe, what else actually? It's really the whole story, in a way. The story of Moshe in a way, kind of echoes in the story of Yonah. The whole story. You have the good. You've given me the terachamim here, which show up first in the golden calf. Also, when Yonah comes into the city, end of Paragimel. Sorry, beginning Paragimel, pasuk dalad, vayachel Yonah lavo ba'ir, right? Vav yud chet lamed. Was that remind you of with Moshe? Vayachal Moshe at pnei Hashem elokav, right? Moshe entreats God, and then remember when he says that od arba'im yom v'ninveh ha'pachet. What does that remind you of? 40 more days and Nineveh will be destroyed. Back of the golden calf, 40 days. Anyone? Moshe's up on the mountain for 40 days and 40 nights. And when Moshe's on the mountain for 40 days and 40 nights, what does he not do for 40 days and 40 nights? Lechem lo achalti, umayim lo shatiti. Does anyone not eat lechem or drink water immediately after the mention of these 40 days? What happens? Keep on reading. Pasuk Zayin and Perek Gimel. The king of Nineveh comes and says, nobody, al yitamu muma, nobody's going to eat anything. Umayim al yishtu, nobody's going to drink. We're all going to fast. Now, it wasn't for 40 days. It didn't end up being that long, but there was this 40-day period. And during this, well, yeah, during this 40-day period, they were going to fast and make sure this thing didn't happen to them. It all is this vaguely reminiscent of Moshe, including these Yud Gimel Midot. What's going on? And even, by the way, at the end, when God changes his mind, right, the language is, what does that remind you of the golden calf? Almost exactly the same language, except instead of the evil being done to Nineveh, the evil is done to his people. It's like these mirror image stories, the golden calf and here. What's happening? You pointed out that in the Yud Gimel Midot that Yonah quotes from Moshe, one of them is missing. Right? Because, and that's right. And isn't that interesting which one is missing? You see, if it were the Yud Gimel Midot HaRachamim, it should have been Kel Rachum V'Chanun, Erech HaPayim V'Rav Chesed V'Emet. But in Yonah's version, it's Chanun V'Rachum, Erech HaPayim V'Rav Chesed V'Nicham Al Hara'a. He actually takes out Emet and replaces it with another phrase, with Nicham al Hara'a. Now, why would he do that? He actually misquotes the Yud Gimel Midot HaRachamim. Of all of them, he would lose Emet. Now go to the first sentence of the book, as you pointed out. Very first sentence of the book. Who is this guy? Vayhi Dvar Hashem El Yonah, and we don't know who his mother is, but we do know who his father is, and who just happens to be his father? Ben Amitai, Yonah, the son of truth. That was the word he left out of the Yud Gimel Midot HaRachamim. Why would he do that? It seems that for Yonah, this all revolves around truth, which is another way of talking about dominoes. If you think about truth, or truth and its synonyms, right? Truth, justice, and the American way, right? If you think about truth and justice, what really is justice? What's the relationship, would you say, between truth and justice? Why do truth and justice go together in the sentence, truth, justice, and the American day? Justice is the execution of truth in the real world. Truth is just an abstract concept. Truth is the laws of physics. Truth is mathematics. What does truth look like in the world of people? It looks like justice. How is that truth? Because the cardinal principle of truth is for every action, there's a consequence. For every consequence, there is an action. That's how truth works. It's how physics works. It's how math works. It's how everything works. Things matter in a world of truth. If A happens, it's going to have an effect on B. B doesn't come from nowhere. It comes from A. That's the great truth equation that lies at the source of everything. Yonah is the son of truth, right? His parents are truth. He's very close to truth. Truth means a tremendous amount to him. And what he's angry about with God, seemingly, is, God, you're compassionate, but you also said back in the Yud Gimel Midot HaRachamim that you were a God of truth. If you think about it, truth was the only one of the Yud Gimel Midot HaRachamim that doesn't actually seem like Rachamim. It actually seems like something else. And what Yonah is really saying is, yeah, Rachamim I'll give you, right? You are a Kel Chanan V'Rachum, Erech HaPayim V'Rav Chesed. But don't tell me that you're also a God of truth, Emet. You know what you are instead? You're Nicham Alara. Sometimes truth demands unpleasant consequences. But you're too much of a pansy for that. Too much into compassion for that. Because when truth demands unpleasant consequences, ra'a consequences, when people do ra'a, that's the train of ra'a, the domino train. When people do ra'a in a world of justice, what should happen to them? Ra'a should happen to them. That's what God was going to do. He was going to do ra'a for them because to them because they had done ra'a. But no, God, you're not doing that. Nicham ala ra'a. You change your mind about doing ra'a. The strange thing about Yonah is that even though Yonah's argument has philosophical resonance, you can make the argument philosophically, not many of us would make that argument. Not many of us are so attached to truth that they would make this argument. Yonah is so attached to truth, he's willing to die for it. He feels that if truth has been abrogated, that it's no longer worth living anymore. It's no longer worth living in a world in which Nineveh is forgiven. Why? If you think about it for a moment, right? Let me give you a mushel or two. When I was in many years ago, I was friends with a professor of philosophy who wrote a book, he wrote a play, and the play was entitled Ivan and Adolf, The Last Man in Hell. He actually had written this play right around the time that I was studying Sefer Yonah, and I found it fascinating because I thought he had unintentionally written a contemporary version of Sefer Yonah itself. In the book, the way it works is it's a fictional book, which is kind of, thank you very much. The book has a kind of whimsy to it. The main idea goes like this. The main characters in the book are the following people. Ivan Karamazov from The Brothers Karamazov by Dostoevsky. He's one person in the book. Next major character is Hitler himself. The book is set in an apartment in hell, right? So these are two people, they're actually in hell, they're in Gehenna. And it turns out that these are the last two people in hell in his book. Why? Because in hell you can get rehabilitated after a while, but these guys are so bad that they're in hell and they're the last people to possibly get rehabilitated. The question is, who's going to be the last man in hell? Is it going to be Ivan or is it going to be Hitler? Hitler's in hell because, with the last person in hell, because he was like the worst person who ever was. He committed all these terrible crimes, killed all the Jews, started World War II, terrible. Ivan, and here's where I would disagree with Vicchio, the author of the book, who was Christian. Ivan, in his view, is in hell because he has decided that no matter what, he is not going to forgive Hitler. No matter what Hitler says, he's not going to forgive him, and that's a crime to never forgive, according to Vicchio. So Ivan is sort of stuck with Hitler in hell. And there's one other person in the play, Sophie, who's a black maid who tends to the apartment, who turns out to be the voice of God. Okay, I mean, this is the way the book actually plays itself out. So basically, there's a scene where, you know, for a while, they're just in hell, they're having these discussions, and Hitler shows no chance of getting out of hell. But then, sort of like in the middle of the book, he starts realizing the gravity of his crimes. And he starts realizing, and he's devastated by what it is that he's done, and he realizes how worthless he is and how really he should never be forgiven. And the problem is that he starts sort of doing tshuva, right? It's like it's the process of tshuva. He has like this terrible charata about what he's done, and it's like, and at this point, Ivan starts getting really nervous because he thinks, like, if Hitler is starting to realize how terrible it is that he did and has this terrible sense of regret, so does that mean he's going to get promoted out of hell? So there's this conversation between Sophie and Hitler, Sophie and Ivan, which kind of goes like this. Ivan says, you know what? If he goes up to heaven, So, and I get a ticket to go up to heaven. I'm not going because I don't want to be in the same heaven that he's in. I don't care what tshuva he's done, right? And then, so Sophie's like saying, no, you can't do that, Ivan. That's really bad. Like, everyone can do tshuva. And he's saying, no, everyone can't do tshuva. I'm sorry. It's like, look at the people he killed. There's no taking back the people he killed. There's 6 million people that are dead because of him. He started war. He ruined countless lives. And what is it? Life is like a badminton game that, you know, it's like it goes back and forth. And when it hits the net, you just declare it a let and the point doesn't count anymore. You're going to tell me it just doesn't count? All the evil that he does, that sorry is just going to erase it all. And we're just going to declare it a let and let him up to heaven. Is that what you're telling me? I found that a rather compelling argument. It's a very interesting question, the theoretical question, could Hitler do tshuva? Are there some things which are beyond doing tshuva? And what is the problem in your mind with the notion that Hitler could do tshuva somehow and be forgiven of his sins? Or even, let's not even take it Hitler, let's just take something even lesser than that. Imagine there was a member of your family who was attacked viciously by someone and their life was ruined. They were raped, God forbid, they were murdered, whatever happened, it was just ghastly, awful, maimed, whatever it was. You thought you'd never find the assailant, but the police eventually do. 9 months later, they track down the person, and they find him. There's incontrovertible DNA evidence. But it turns out that the fellow is rich, and he is able to muster a dream team of lawyers, right, who defend him to the hilt. He has the best possible team of lawyers. And you do whatever you can to raise money, the prosecution, but the trial goes on, and it's this show trial, and there's television cameras, and there's the whole thing, and it's like the worst parts of your life, and the trial's dragging on, and there's procedural maneuvers that they take to just drag things out, and finally, after 6 months of the trial, the judges calls you into chambers and wants to talk with you. And the judge says the following: this show trial has gone on long enough. I've spoken to the defendant. The defendant is willing to come over to your house tomorrow afternoon and, you know, apologize for anything that may or may not have happened on the night of April 21st. And I want you to just be there. You'll have a little drink with him. I want you to just be a man, be a woman. I just want you to accept that apology and then call a little press conference and just say that you're dropping the charges and that, you know, that bygones have to be bygones and you have to just move on right now and there's a future ahead for everybody and let's not tie up the justice system anymore. This is how I want you to end this. As you walk out of that courtroom, right, what would you feel like doing to that judge? Right? Wouldn't you feel like strangling that judge? Right? It's like, so imagine that, you know, you woke up in the middle of the night and you realize it was a dream, that terrible scene. Do you know what I mean? But that was like the worst nightmare you could have, that that would actually happen. And that, but the court case is still on. But you know what? I'll give you a nightmare that's even worse. A nightmare that's even worse than that nightmare. The nightmare goes like this. You're asleep at night in the middle of this court case. And the nightmare you have is not that the judge calls you into chambers and makes that speech to you, but the master of the universe comes to you in a prophecy and makes that same speech. I've spoken to the defendant, he's gonna apologize, I want you to just accept the apology, I want you to move on. This is God signing out, master of the universe, just to prove that this is actually God and not a hallucination. There'll be a little note underneath your pillow, right? You look under, you wake up with a start, cold sweat. You look underneath your pillow, there's this little note. Yeah, the dream was real, the part about you apologizing, you know, love God, right? And it's like you wake up and it's actually true. God communicated this way. Now what do you want to do? Why is this worse? And what would you want to do? Right, that's true. So my point is, though, that in this kind of situation, let me ask you this, why is this worse? Why is this nightmare worse than the nightmare about the judge?
Because this says there's no divine justice.
Exactly. Because if the nightmare happened with the judge, you could always say, fine, the judge is crazy, but there is a judge in heaven, and there will ultimately be justice. But if you have the second nightmare, where God himself tells you to do this, there is no more court to go to. That's it. At that point, what would you want to do if you really had that nightmare? You'd want to die. That's what Yonah wants to do. He wants to die. Yonah had that nightmare. The reason why you'd want to die is not just because it's your person. The reason why you'd want to die is because if that could be true, then you're really saying that life is no longer worth living. If justice doesn't reign in the world to that level, if there is no consequence and actions for things, then nothing really matters. Meaning itself is stripped out of life if there is no justice, which is why we have an interest in there being justice in the world. The fact that there is justice allows the world to make sense. The same way that the laws of physics are mathematical laws, and they make sense because they're mathematical laws, there's truth in the laws. In justice, life makes sense to us if there is some kind of justice, even if we don't know what it is. But if you strip that out, if God comes and says, no, there is no justice, right, and sorry makes it all go away, this is the problem. Does sorry destroy justice? Does the idea of tshuva itself make the world less meaningful place? Does it abrogate justice? And Yonah says yes. And now read the story. Here's how the story goes. One day, Yonah has the nightmare, and God comes to him, and he has the dream. Here are these guys, the wicked neighboring nation next door, and they've done all these awful things, and they are going to be forgiven. All you got to do is get them to do tshuva. Yonah, you're the guy. But Yonah's ben amitai. He's not doing it. He runs away. You would want to run away too. The problem is you can't run away from God. Okay, you can't run away from God. It'd still make you want to run away, which is why Yonah runs away, even though it's futile. I'm going to run. Don't tell me it's futile. I'm running. There's nowhere to run to. I'm running anyway, right? If you tell me there's no justice in the world, I'm going to run. So he runs. And it's funny. He doesn't even run from his mission. According to the text, he runs milifnei Hashem. He runs from before God. We have nothing to talk about. I need to be out of your domain. So I'm going to run. So he goes and he runs onto a ship, Vayered, and he goes into the ship. All of a sudden he's on the ship, and what's happening? There's a storm. What's the storm? Who's the storm? The storm is God. What's God saying with the storm? You can't run away. Yonah, we got to talk, right? Okay, now isn't it interesting that the text goes out of its way to tell you that here it is, there's all these sailors, right? And all these sailors are pagans, and they're all crying out to their gods. They're all of a sudden very frum, these guys. They're all davening because there's this storm. Yonah, where is he? Yonah goes down to the bottom of the hold. Vayishkav vayiradem. He takes a nap. Like, why does the text even have to tell you that? And can you imagine? It's like nap time. Like, imagine there's a storm, a divine storm, the perfect storm, 50-foot waves, you know what I mean? You're in a 400 BC Mediterranean wooden fishing vessel, you know what I mean? And it's like these huge waves. Are you going to go to sleep in the hold right now? This is nap time? If Yonah goes to sleep, it must have been a pretty determined Yonah. Why is he going to sleep? The answer is he's running away again. He knows who the storm is, right? Okay, God, you're saying talk? I have nothing to say to you. If you aren't going to let me run away onto the ship, I'll run away into sleep. It's the only place left. So he wills himself to sleep at the bottom of the hold in the middle of the storm. Unlucky for him, the Rava Chavel, the captain, comes and wakes him up and says, are you crazy? Nobody is, right? Everyone's davening. What about you? He goes up to the deck. Everyone is davening. If you look carefully, Yonah doesn't say a word. He doesn't say a word. There's no entreaty to God. He has nothing to say to God. At that point, the people come and they say, what should we do? We cast lots. It's you. He says, throw me overboard. Why did he say throw me overboard? He doesn't know there's a fish. What does he think is going to happen if you throw him overboard? He's going to die. It's the first time he wants to die. What's Yonah really saying then? It's another way out. Don't you get it, right? It's that if you're not going to let me run away onto the boat, and you're not going to let me run away into sleep, so then I'll take the ultimate runaway. I'll run away into death. It's the only way out. I'm not talking to you. So they throw him overboard. When they throw him overboard, along comes a fish, and God says, no, you're not getting out of it so easy, right? And there's going to be a fish that swallows you, you're going to stay alive. Let's see what happens then. Now enter Chazal, and you see where Chazal are coming from. What did Chazal say? You want to know why there were two fish? Chazal are saying, midrashically, not pshat, but midrashically, all they did is they saw in pshat the succession of running away, running away, running away, and they said, and you know, even when he was in the fish, he wasn't davening. He had nothing to say. The only way that God forced him to confront him was by, when he wasn't davening, spitting him into another fish that was pregnant, where there was no room, and when he's actually physically stuck with no way out. So that's the only time that he opens his mouth and begins to speak to God. But by the way, the notion of a pregnant fish is an important notion. We'll come back to it in a second. So here is, what? Yeah, I know, that's a strange thing. But that Chazal tells the fish was pregnant, lots of eggs. Okay, so anyway, here's the deal. Here is Yonah, he calls out to God. And if you listen to his prayer, it's interesting. His prayer is, thank you, God, for saving me. I thought that I would have no connection to you anymore. I thought I slammed the door on you, nigrashti mi negedei necha, that you would have nothing to do with me. Achosif labit al hechel kachecha, but I see that you still care about me. Thank you very much. I appreciate it, God, right? So because bottom line is, even someone who commits suicide, right, halfway down, you know, halfway down the fall, right? You cry out for life, and God listened to that cry and saved him, so thank you, God. Next thing that happens, but what's interesting is what the prayer does not include is tshuva, no tshuva, and no changing his mind. Philosophically, Yonah's in the same place as he was before. So Yonah gets spit out of the fish, and here comes God again. By the way, Yonah, Nineveh, right? Remember Nineveh? Got to go to Nineveh now. Now here you are, and Yonah's like, there's no way out. But Yonah hasn't changed. So now what are you going to do? So here's Yonah. He does it, because what's he going to do? So he goes 40 more days, Nineveh is going to be destroyed, and he's hoping against hope that what he thinks is going to happen isn't going to happen, but it does. The nightmare actually happens. They do tshuva. God, the judge, says, fine. Everything's good. And then it's at this point he says, look, I just want to die. I can't live in this world anymore. If this is the world, then I don't want to live in it. You know why? I'm the son of truth. I know what truth is. You claimed that you were the God of truth. You said that Emmet was part of the Yud Gimel Midat HaRachman, but guess what? It isn't. You know what you are instead? You're Nicham Al Hara. You're a God that when Emmet gets too hard, when Emmet gets too painful, then you just get soft and you won't follow through. And there is no domino effect. Right? There should have been. They did ra'a. Ra'a was deserved. And you won't do it. You're nicham al ha-ra'a. You change your mind about doing ra'a. Don't tell me that you're a God of Emmet. That's Yonah. He's a pretty tough cookie. So if you're God, what are you going to say to Yonah? The answer is, God says nothing to Yonah. Instead, he makes him experience something. And it's the experience he has that is going to try to teach him something. He gives him a plant. And I'll go back to why the plant was there. For two reasons. Liot sel al rosho, to give him shade. Latzil lo mira'ato, to save him from his ra'a. But the shade he already had. So how is this plant, which is there to give him shade, how is it going to latzil lo mira'ato? How is it going to save him from this ra'a, from this way of looking at the world, from his anger at the fact that God changed his mind? How's it going to do that? So back to Michael. Michael, why are you really happy with this plant? Here you were in your sukkah, you had shade, but then all of a sudden out of nowhere, God makes this plant come up. Gorgeous leaves. You go out of there and you take shelter underneath the leaf. Why are you into this plant? This extra beautiful thing that I have now, that God made just for me. Sure, I had my shade, right? But you know what? It's even the fact that I had my shade, but God cared enough and made shade for me anyway. That was really very sweet of God. I'll go out of my little sukkah. I'll take advantage of God's shade. And you're kind of into this plant now, right? Because this plant is like this manifestation of love. And it's really, really wonderful. Along comes a worm. And the worm destroys the plant. And now, Yonah wants to die again. God says, how are you feeling? He says, I'm so angry I could die. That's a little strange. I'm so angry I could die. Like, I mean, yesterday you didn't have the plant, and like, you know, you had your sukkah. It's like, why are you so into the plant? But somebody who's really gotten attached to that plant, why is he so angry he could die? Let's think about this in terms of rachamim and din for a moment, because these are the issues. Din, rachamim. What is rachamim? Compassion. In a world of din, does that plant exist? Where does that plant come from? It comes from God's love. It just came from nowhere. It didn't come from a seed. See, that's the trouble with that plant. It was a miracle that made that plant. Most plants come from seeds. When a plant comes from seed, then that's din. That's cause and effect. You plant a seed, you get a plant. That works. This plant didn't come from a seed. It just showed up. It showed up out of love. You know what that worm is? What is the worm taking away the plant? Din. The worm is din looking at that plant and says, hello, I represent justice. In a world of justice, you're out of here. You do not belong. Show me your building permit. Show me your seed. Ain't no seed, ain't no plant. Fair is fair. Now, Yonah, why are you so upset now? The gourd is gone and you want to die. Why do you want to die? You see, the first time you wanted to die was when Nineveh got forgiven because you didn't want to live in a world where din is compromised. Why do you want to die now?
I want to live in a world where rachamim is compromised.
That's right. Because I don't want to live in a world where there's no rachamim, right? What is the argument for rachamim for that plant? If you were Yonah and you were going to articulate the argument for the plant, what if you could argue against the worm? What argument would you make? The worm comes along and says, sorry, I'm looking at your papers. There's no building permit. There's no seed. I really hate to do this. I just have to take you away. Gorgeous, big, beautiful plant, all these leaves. Right? The second before the worm comes, if you're Yonah and you can make the argument to tell the worm to stop, what would you say? Okay, except that the word deserve won't work because deserve is a din word. Deserve only works in din. What you'd have to say is fine, the plant doesn't deserve to exist.
Maybe it still should.
But maybe it should continue to exist anyway. Should you really just get rid of that plant that's already here because it doesn't deserve to exist? There's another argument for the plant, which is maybe it doesn't deserve to exist, but it's here, and it's beautiful, and it's providing shade. It would be such a shame to get rid of it, such a waste to get rid of it. The truth is that rachamim actually has its own logic, but it's a different logic than din. Din's logic is completely past-based. Rachamim's logic is completely future-based. The logic of din is the logic of the prosecutor, the logic of the judge. If the judge imposes din, there's only one question he wants to know about the defendant in front of him. It's a question having to do with the past. And that question is, did you do it? Right? What did you do? If you did it, I'll tell you what the consequence is. That's din. For every act, there's a consequence. For every consequence, there's an act. Show me what you did, and I'll tell you the consequence. But there's another whole system, a system of rachamim. We mistake rachamim. We think rachamim is just being soft. Rachamim is just lack of din. That's not what rachamim is. Rachamim is a force that has its own logic, but it's a future-based force. It's not a past-based force. Din asks a question, what did you do? Guess what? Rachamim also asks a question, but it's not a question about the past. It's a question about the future. What is the question that Rachamim asks about the future to decide whether Rachamim is warranted or not? What is your potential? What can you do? What can you become? That is the question of Rachamim. The question of Rachamim, the question that any defense attorney will ask, right, is, okay, so maybe they did it. Maybe they don't deserve to exist in a world of din, but they're here. Look what they can become. Look what they can become. Look what the plant can become. You're going to take it all away, this beautiful plant that I'm connected to, just because it doesn't deserve to be here? That would be such a tragedy, such a shame to get rid of that. You see, if in Rachamim the answer is no, then the answer is no. If there is no potential, there is no potential. But if the answer is yes, then there's an argument to save the plant. The word Rachamim is an interesting word, isn't it? What's the shorish? Rechem. Womb. What does womb mean? The answer is really, so Emmanuel Levinas, the French philosopher, once said, interestingly enough, he says that people think that there's this idea out there called compassion, and there's this idea out there called femininity, and women just happen to be more compassionate than men. Levinas says it's actually the other way around. There is no idea called compassion. The only idea is femininity. Compassion is derivative from femininity. Femininity is compassion. It's wombness. Think about what a womb is. What does a womb do? What question does a womb ask? Imagine a womb asking the question of din. I'm sorry, give me 3 minutes and we're done. Right? Imagine a womb asking the question of din. Right? For every fertilized egg that seeks to implant inside a womb and grow, what if the womb asked, what did you do to deserve being here? There's no such thing as a child, right? You can't ask that question if you're a womb, but there is a question you can ask. What potential do you have? And biochemically, a womb does ask that question. A womb actually evaluates every fertilized egg to decide whether it has potential or doesn't. And if it doesn't have potential, it won't nurture it. It drops it. It becomes a miscarriage, right? And 80% of pregnancies will actually end in very, very early miscarriages. A woman never even knows she's pregnant because the womb just rejected the zygote. But the womb's question is a question about potential. What potential do you have? That's what God was telling Yonah. God was saying, ah, you didn't want to live in a world where din is compromised, but now I show you that you don't want to live in a world without rachamim either. Rachamim is not the absence of din. It's a whole different way of thinking. It's about the future, and it's in that realm that tshuva works. You see, tshuva doesn't make you deserve to live. This is a mistake we often make. We think, you did tshuva, I did tshuva, now I deserve to live. No. Tshuva does not make you deserve to live. You did it. If you did it, din says, show me what you did and I'll show you the consequence, and tshuva is irrelevant in din. Tshuva is only relevant in a world of rachamim. There's another appeal that you can make to God, and that appeal is what God says. You know who I am? There's another difference between din and rachamim. With this, I'll close. Din is objective. And there's nothing more subjective than rachamim. Din is very mathematical. It's just cut and dry. Show me what you did, and I'll show you the consequences. But rachamim is subjective as it's supposed to be. The more you have to do with something, the more rachamim you'll have for it. That's why God gave the kikayon to Yonah and allowed Yonah to benefit from it. Because if it was just a thing, he wouldn't have had rachamim for it. But once that thing provided him with something, it wasn't just the air conditioning anymore. It was like, wow, this plant. All of a sudden, you're connected to that plant. And now I'll make the argument for rachamim. Like, it's such a wonderful plant. Like, forget that I'm getting air conditioning from it. Look, it's a great plant. It's got the stem. It's got all these leaves. It's like, why would you want to get rid of it? He understands. And God says, you know what? You understand because you're a little bit subjectively connected to it. Who's the most subjective person in the world? A mother. A mother is never going to want, right? Din can say to the ends of the earth that your child has no more chances. And a mother says, I don't care. I just want to know what his potential is. I just don't care. The closer you are to that, and God says, you know who I am? I'm a mother. He says, Ata chasta likikayona shelo amata bov likidalto. You're just connected because he gave you some air conditioning. You never worked for that plant. You never raised that plant. And you still had rachamim for that plant. Vani lo alchus al ninve, ha'ir hagdola, and I'm the creator, and I created all these people, and I shouldn't have compassion on them. Yeah, they did tshuva. I'm not saving them because of tshuva. Tshuva just allows me to save them, and that's all tshuva does. What does tshuva do? Tshuva is very important. But all it does is give you potential. If you do tshuva, then what it says is you can't go to God and say, I deserve to live, because deserve is a din word. But what you can go to God is say, look, I've changed. And because I've changed, look at what I can become. It's like I'm this blank slate. What I will become, I don't know, but look at all this potential. Wouldn't it be a shame to get rid of me? And you're the most subjective one in the world because you're my creator. So have compassion upon me. That, I think, is what Yonah learns at the end of the book. And that, I think, is what we learn and why we read it on Yom Kippur. Have a good Yom Kippur.